then come to the net, they'll get caught up in it. And eventually something big or many smaller animals will get caught in that net and it will sink down to the bottom of the seabed. At the bottom of the seabed then, scavengers will come along, they'll eat the decomposing animals that are caught in that net. Some of those scavengers will then get caught up in the net as well, but eventually what will happen is that that net will then come free again and it will go back into the sea where it will then continue to fish until someone takes it out. And human intervention can happen at any point during that cycle. So Ghost Fishing UK started here in 2015. This is a picture of Pascal van Erp, who is a Dutchman, and Rich Walker, who started Ghost Fishing UK, met him in Croatia. Rich was teaching a GUE course, had a day off, met Pascal, they got talking, and Pascal invited him to go along on a lift that they were doing. From that moment then, Rich decided that, you know, there's quite a lot of ghost fishing gear here in the UK, and that we should do something about it. So in 2015, Pascal brought a team over from the Netherlands, and they set up to Scapafloat, where they had a boat which was half ghost fishing team from the Netherlands and half people from the UK who were going to become the core ghost fishing team. They went out on MV Holton and they basically set about training the first people in the UK. In 2016 then, those core members went back up to Scapa and trained the further six people to become Ghost Fishing UK members. And we've had some great support from various companies in the UK. This is part of the haul that they brought up in 2016. Okay. Has anyone here dived Scapafloat? Does anyone know what I mean by Scapa? Yeah? Okay, so we're talking about Orkney Islands. So you head north. Get to Scotland, head north a bit further, hit Inverness, think you're pretty much there, keep going north. When you run out of land, keep going north, and you end up in Orkney. German World War I fleet were captured and brought into the Orkney Islands, and they scuttled the wrecks in 1919. And those ships are some of the most amazing diving in the world. With wrecks, you get fish. With fish, you get fishermen. Okay, and so basically, a lot of nets have been caught up there. A lot of lobster pots have been lost, and a lot of lines have been put in, shot lines for divers that have been abandoned, broken, and needed cleaning up. So this was part of the work they did in 2016. These lobster pots, actually, just going back to that, at the moment, okay, they are designed to catch. Okay, and then someone comes along, they look at the lobster pots, they take out lobsters, they get shipped off to various restaurants, etc. These lobster pots are designed so that lobsters can't get out, crabs or anything else that are caught in there. There is no break hatch in them at the moment, but it is something that they are looking into introducing because these will continue to fish until that breaks down, which at the moment is quite a long time. So they're looking at escape hatches, which basically will break down much quicker. They need to be replaced, so if they get lost, that the animals can eventually get back out again. So, this is Scapafloat, so I've given you a brief history. I won't give you a full Scapafloat history. I'm sure you can arrange that another time if you really want. But there's a big, big project up there called Clean Up Scapa, and the majority of skippers that work with diving, a lot of the fishing industry, they're all involved up there to work together so that if you know, shot lines are lost, if fishing lines are lost, or if nets are lost, or you know, these lines and lines of bucky pots, which are plastic pots with net over the top so that shellfish go into the top and can't get back out again. When they get lost, that's actually the livelihood of the fishermen. So they want them back as well. So the best thing that can happen, as soon as they get lost, they tell us, we arrange for a survey, and we go and lift it and get it back to them. Can be quite dangerous work, okay, so that's why there's quite a lot of training involved. And when you're starting to play with heavy objects on the bottom and sending them surface down, you don't really want to get caught up in it. Amazing stuff that was found up there, vacuum cleaners, car batteries, lorry batteries, all sorts of stuff we don't want at the bottom of the ocean. 2017 then, so last September, they ran the biggest training trip up there. They had Sunrise as well as Halton. And there was a full dedicated training boat out there as well. And in 2017, the activities ramped up on the south coast, primarily in Cornwall, Devon and Dorset. Does anyone know what this is? No? Yeah, it is scallop drawer. Okay. So basically this gets dragged along the seabed. The metal bits at the end basically tickle the scallops, they all swim up and get caught up in it. This is the same dredger underwater. Those of you who've dived up Halton, this is Bob, the skipper from Halton. And you can see just the amount of marine life that's caught up in that thing before they lifted it. Part of it was also under the seabed, so it's quite a complicated lift. Okay, this was the haul from 2017, so this is I think it was 5 days of diving, one boat of deep technical divers who were cleaning up the wrecks, and one boat that were a training boat, so they were learning how to do this. And that's what they retrieved in 1 week. Then in 2017, we really started ramping things up and team building, so we started building more regional cells, training, and I'll come on to a bit more about training in a minute, but just to make sure that we stay safe. So swimming around the bottom of the ocean is a really bad plan. You know, we're not meant to be there. When you then start introducing lift bags that are going to send you to the surface at a rate of knots, that's quite a bad idea too. When you then start introducing extremely sharp knives, things that you can get tangled in and everything else, yeah, you know, generally we have to be quite careful that we make sure we're nice and safe. And we also have to make sure that we stay legal. We do have to ensure that we have the correct licenses in place. Because unfortunately, what is one person's litter is another person's treasure, and there's quite a fine line between what you can and cannot lift. So we need to get licenses to lift anything that we need mechanical aid for, which includes lift bags or winches or anything else when we're pulling out hundreds of kilos in it. Clean up Scapa Flow, so I touched on that briefly. It's a big project that's ongoing with multiple organisations trying to return or recycle a lot of the things that we pick up, and I'll talk a bit more about recycling. And there's also quite a lot of scientific research that's involved. So we've got someone from Heriot-Watt, and I'll show some pictures of her as well, because they actually go into quite granular detail of what gets taken out of those nets and pots that we bring up. We had some great support last year from a number of different organisations. And the cells are now growing, so we've got people all around the UK who are supporting us. It was literally up until about a year ago that it was primarily in Cornwall with a cell in Somerset, but we're now expanding across the south coast. We've got people in London, north of London, Somerset Way, and up in Scotland as well. Once we get reports, and I'll talk to you a bit about how you can report gear, we then go and deploy a team if appropriate. They'll then do a survey. They'll build a local team, so it might be that I, for example, get called out to somewhere in Sussex. I might have to take local divers who aren't Ghost Fishing UK team to go and survey that, so take video footage, measurements, that kind of thing, so less risky. And then we pull in the Ghost Fishing UK team who are able to lift. Onto a bit more of training, but this is some of the pictures that we used from the training in Scapa Flow last year. So you can see top left picture are some of the lift bags that were carried by the team. Top right, Rich Walker showing people how to safely deploy a lift bag, not quite as simple as you would think. And then carrying on the bottom, bigger lift bags, the risks that they have, and then some knives, which these are incredibly sharp. If anyone's ever tried to cut through some of the ropes or fishing line, you'll find that it is quite hard work. So we use very, very sharp knives. In 2018, then, we did a winter warmer project down in Portland. We had four boats that went out, which, given it was the first weekend in January, was pretty amazing. They were full, and we had quite a long wait list. So 48 divers got out of bed at some ridiculous hour the first weekend in January and went out to sea. We did some survey work, and unfortunately on the Sunday we were blown out, but the team did an amazing job. They rigged all sorts of stuff and we had to cut it down and it was really interesting. We've now written our own training course, which is a 3-day training course, and it covers everything from team diving and key skills that become really, really important when you're working in this kind of environment, down to, you know, being able to be completely motionless in the water while you're assessing someone else cutting something that could potentially take them straight to the surface. We've had activities already in Cornwall. I don't know if anyone here heard, we did a big lift on the Hopper Barge 42 in Plymouth a few weeks ago that got quite a lot of press coverage. We can't talk in too much detail about projects we've got coming up for a number of reasons, but we are lifting in the next couple of weeks off a wreck in Portland, and we've got a project down in Brighton, which is our first Sussex-based project, to do a survey on quite a big net down there. And just a couple of images. This actually was the final piece of string that was holding this net down. And I believe there were something like 6 or 7 lift bags that were trying to take it to the surface. So it's not all, you know, about being that person who cuts that last bit. Behind them, there'll be someone who's who we term donkey. Okay, they will have lift bags, you know, up to 6 or 8 lift bags. They will have cylinders that are purely used to fill those lift bags. We don't use our breathing gas. We kind of need that. So they will carry 2, 3, maybe 4 extra cylinders that they can pass off as people need them. And then you'll have someone who, for some reason, people kind of think they're not that important. Supervisor. I call them supervisor. Everyone else kind of thinks they're just, you know, the torch holder. But this is the person who will just put a hand in front of you. And as soon as that hand appears in front of you, you freeze. It means something's not right. It means that net's wrapped around your twin set. It means you're about to go surface bound. You're caught on something. And they will literally tell you to freeze until they've untangled you, and then you can carry on. So, as nice as the last picture looked, it's not really the conditions we tend to work in. It tends to look a bit more like this. Okay, as much as we are naturally buoyant, we stay off the seabed. Generally, we have to rock things, you have to pull things, you have to try and get rid of them out of the seabed. So I mentioned earlier, we had this course that now exists. It's based on the work that was done in SCAPA. It's a 3-day course, some of which is delivered now online via Skype. And it is now a requirement for our project. So if you're going to be lifting nets, we do require people to do it. And it keeps us safe as divers. It is currently invitation only, because the course is funded. We have found we have a lot of people who are really keen to get involved, which is wonderful. And they want to come along and they want to come and lift nets, which is great. But when they show up once and then we never see them again, or they're not willing to go out on their own and go and find, you know, is a report genuine? Are they able to get a team in place to go and support them? That kind of thing. It becomes quite difficult for us as a charity to continue to support. And the key way to get involved is to submit reports. I'll mention that again at the end about how you can best tell us what you found and where you found it. So biggest problem that we have is what happens once we get it, okay? You can imagine you pull up 100 tons of net and it's been down there for however long, it's got however many dead animals in there. Okay, funnily enough, people don't want you just to dump it on their whole wall. Not really something I want in my garden or in the back of my van, frankly. You know, have that in my back of my van for 2 days and then have to sleep in it next weekend, which is not ideal. It is quite a complicated thing that we do. We do put them in the back of our vans, we drive them around to various people's houses, and we dump them in people's gardens. People do know that, just to be clear, okay? You can't just randomly someone's garden. And some of our team members have literally got containers, you know, the shipping containers, huge things, in the back of their garden, full of this stuff. Not my garden, I live in London. Wouldn't fit in my garden. But it's not particularly pleasant stuff. Unfortunately, it's very difficult for us to get it recycled as well. So we actually send a lot of it onto mainland Europe. But you can imagine that it's quite costly. And so we end up having to fill full shipping containers before we're actually able to make them. They then go off. We generally send them to a company called Ecomil. Has anyone come across them? No? Anyone who's been up on our stand, we've got socks up there that were for sale. I think we're down to the last pair. T-shirts as well, they do stuff like that. Okay, so lost and abandoned fishing gear ends up with stuff that you can wear. And anyone here come across the Ocean Positive range by Fourth Element? Yeah, okay, I've got some of their gear. Really, really nice swimwear, actually. I'm a dive instructor. It goes in the pool about 6 hours a week, and it still seems to be okay. So, you know, probably the durability of the fishing gear has sorted us. Okay, so they've got some great stuff. Fat Face have just launched a range, and a lot more companies are now coming on board as well. Then we've got ropes. These were pulled out from Skeka. Okay, there's a gentleman up there who has a company called Afraid Not, which is probably one of the best company names I've ever heard of. Okay, basically people will find ropes, whether it be beach cleanups, Skeka cleanup,